There we go. All right. We really appreciate you being here this morning. This is, process has been going on for quite some time, and I'm going to introduce the person that really has been the focal point of getting us to this point, and that's Denise. Where are you? Denise, would you stand up? Denise Ross. If you want to know where the bodies are buried, talk to Denise. She's done a lot of research and has helped organize those. She keeps us on the cemetery board in tow, and so Denise has a lot to do with what's been going on here at the cemetery and helping us organize this. Let me introduce the people, our guests this morning that are going to be speaking. Mayor Jose Lazarga. We're privileged to have State Representative Nancy McClain with us this morning. We have Kay Mooring, who is on the cemetery board, and she'll be giving us some information. We have another honored guest is Arizona Humanities Council Director Brenda Thompson. And one of Quartzsite's own, Dennis Dole, will talk about high jolly. If you would stand for the presentation of the color guard. Shane, color guard, please.
Join me in the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Let's pray. Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you for the opportunity that you've given us to join in this service, in this dedication. God, we ask that you would continue to bless the United States of America and for the service people that give us the freedoms that we enjoy. Amen.
Amen.
You may be seated. I'd like to introduce the council members. If you're here, would you please come over here and stand to the side so that we can recognize you? I already introduced Mayor Jose Lazarga, Vice Mayor Barbara Howell. She's here. Bob Kelly, Joe Winslow, Jerry Lucason, Pat Anderson, and Mike Jewett. Would you please welcome them by giving them a round of applause? And would you join these people there? I would like to introduce the cemetery board members. Kay Mooring, up here on the platform. She's the vice chairman. Eileen Lunsford, would you please come forward? Art Larson. Dee Sheehan. Ralph Martin. And Sandy Scott. These are the people that I work with on a continuing basis, and I just really appreciate everything that they have done and made contributions, taking their time to come out here and make sure that this, the cemetery, is a place where we can be proud of. The next person I'd like to introduce is our town manager, Alex Taft. Would you please come forward? Alex has been a real blessing, again, for the cemetery board and the town. She kind of started some of this, so it's all her fault. But you know what? It's just been real beneficial to have a cemetery that we can be really proud of, and I would like to thank Alex for her contributions and everything that she's done as well. Thank you. Maybe see you. This time I would like to introduce Quartzsite Mayor Jose Lizarga.
Thank you everybody for coming out today.
There we go, no closer.
Thank you everybody for coming out today. I'll try to keep this a little bit short. If everybody was in shorts and Hawaiian shirts, I might talk a little bit longer, but since everybody's in jackets, we're going to try to keep this as short as possible. You know, none of the stuff would be possible without the volunteers of these people and the amazing attitudes and what they've been able to accomplish over a very short period of time out here. Years and years ago, when I first came to Quartzsite, I came out here and walked around, and there was definitely some things that needed to be done. And the hard work and once again, the amazing efforts of these people and volunteering, a lot of people to volunteer at the time, have made this possible. You know, I went and did a little bit of research on this man that we're going to talk about today, and it's hard to believe that a decision made back before the Civil War has caused us all to be sitting here today and talking about it, and an amazing piece of history, and thank the people that they keep that history alive, because it is part of our it is part of our tradition, it's part of what we do, and without history, we're bound to repeat it if we don't learn from it. So, thank you so much, and we'll continue on.
Well, I think I'm... Okay.
And I'd like to go ahead and introduce State Representative Mr. Pine.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Did I turn it off?
No, I
just have money. Okay. Thank you, Mr. Mayor, and I'd also like to thank the town and the cemetery board for inviting me to speak here today and to be here for this rather important cemetery or ceremony. It is quite fitting as we are about to observe Arizona Centennial, as this is really a very unique Arizona monument and event that happened here in Arizona. I learned about the Camel Corps quite some time ago, even before I moved into Arizona. But as I've been in Phoenix the last couple of days, and as I was speaking to folks around town, I was surprised to learn how few people actually knew of the Camel Corps and the role that High John played in its development. So I'm hoping that this designation as the National Register of Historic Places will actually encourage a lot more folks in Arizona to learn about their history. As most of you know here, Lieutenant Edward Beale, leader of the first expedition from Texas to California and back in 1857, believed that he had completed a successful mission and referred to the camel as this economical and noble brute. Secretary of War John Floyd urged Congress to authorize the purchase of an additional 1,000 camels, but not everyone agreed, citing as one of the problems that the camels frightened the Army's burros, horses, and mules. And then the advent of the Civil War was the final blow, and the project was discontinued. High Jolly, and I can't even try to pronounce his original name, was recruited to teach the soldiers how to pack and drive the animals. He appears to have been quite a colorful character, as he is the most famous name of all the men hired for that purpose. After the Camel Corps was disbanded, High Jolly started a freight business along the Colorado River, supplying mining camps to the east with a few camels that he kept. When that failed, he released the camels into the desert. He spent some time in Tucson, and in his final years moved to Quartzsite, where he died in 1902. It is said that, even then, he believed that a few of the camels still roamed the desert. This designation is a fitting tribute both to High Jolly and the other bold men who dared to try. Thank you.
Thank you very much. We sent out several letters asking people to be here. And again, State Representative McLean was gracious enough to be here, but we also have others, and I'd like to acknowledge them. Senator John Kyle had to be in Washington, D.C., but he sends his apologies, and he wishes that he following letter, and I'd like to read it for you. Dear Town of Quartzsite, I am honored to have been invited to participate in the dedication of the High Jolly Monument to the National Register of Historic Places, as designated by the United States Department of the Interior. This dedication is important to the rich culture of the state, the Arizona Centennial, as well as the history of the Town of Quartzsite. As one of only four pyramidal monuments in existence in the state of Arizona, the commemoration of the High Jolly Monument is long overdue. The monument is a major tourist attraction and is also a considerable source of revenue for the state of Arizona and today's hurting economy. The High Jolly Monument, as the historic resting place of Greek immigrant explorer High Jolly, is a national and state treasure. We are proud of its dedication to the National Register. The expedition of the experimental United States Camel Corps explored northern Arizona, seeking better means of communication and shipping. This famous exploration of the United States Camel Corps through the Southwest and historic Quartzsite is now archived, attesting to our state's rich history dating from pre-statehood. Congratulations to the Town of Quartzsite and to the state of Arizona for the dedication of a monument commemorating High Jolly and other immigrants who lived and died exploring our great Southwest. Sincerely, Raul Grijalva, Member of Congress. We also asked Governor Jan Brewer, and she did send an email, and she will be sending a letter that we will have in our files, and actually quite a bit of this information will be posted in the museum, so if you would like to read it for yourself, please visit the Quartzsite Museum. There's a lot of interesting facts in there, and you will really enjoy that. Mayor Joseph Dekonich sent the following letter. It is with great honor that I write this letter commemorating the dedication of the High Jolly Monument to the National Register of Historic Places. I am sorry that I will be unable to be with you on December 17th for the dedication. However, I would be remiss if I did not speak to the event in this manner. Brought to this country specifically because of his expertise in handling camels, High Jolly served this country well with his service in the U.S. Army. What great courage it must have taken to head up what was known as the camel experiment in what was undoubtedly a remote and desolate part of the country then known as the Great American Desert. The fact that he chose to live out the remainder of his life at Quartzsite during a time long before superhighways and air conditioning is further testament to that courage. Even after the camel service was eliminated, High Jolly continued to serve in the U.S. Army and even became an American citizen. The erection of the monument way back in 1935 was a fitting tribute to a true pioneer of the American West, and dedicating it to the National Register of Historic Places here in 2011 is most appropriate. My thanks to Denise Ross, Bruce Sword of the High Jolly Cemetery, as well as all others, elected and otherwise, who have had the foresight and determination to see this dedication. Sincerely, Joseph Dekonich, Mayor, Blythe, California. And then we were really excited to receive a letter from High Jolly's great step-granddaughter, Leota Smalley, and I would like to read that. Dear Denise Ross and Bruce Sword, thank you for inviting me to attend the dedication of the High Jolly Monument to the National Register of Historic Places. Due to health reasons, it is not possible for me to attend the dedication. High Jolly had three children, one son and two daughters. None of his children had any children. His daughter Amelia was my grandfather's, George Ernest Smalley, second wife, not my biological grandmother. They lived in Tucson, Arizona. At some point in time, High Jolly's other daughter, Minnie Tedrow Humsford, came to live with George and Amelia. By the time I first remembered meeting my grandfather, Amelia and Minnie, my grandfather, was confined to a wheelchair due to crippling arthritis, and Amelia and Minnie had to completely care for all of his needs. After George and Amelia died, Minnie continued living in the home in Tucson. When Minnie could no longer live alone, she was moved to Rialto, California with my family, Arthur Denmark. Mark Smalley, George's son, and Jeanette Smalley, and their two children, three children, Shirley, Leota, and Glenn. Minnie lived with us until her death in the early 50s, I think. I think she is buried at Forest Lawn in Southern California. Have a great dedication, and congratulations on your acceptance, again, to the National Register of Historic Places. Sincerely, Leota Smalley Gruber. And again, the original copy of this letter will be in the museum. Now I'd like to introduce Kay Mooring, and she's going to talk a little bit why we are here this morning.
Did you ever wonder why this monument and how it got here? Why did it? What? Who made it? In the 1930s, Mrs. Solomon Coos, who knew High Jolly, attempted to have a monument erected in his memory. But before enough money could be raised, James L. Edwards, the state highway foreman, and his crew, at no expense to the state, and on their own time, erected the commemorative pyramidical monument over his grave. Construction material of local resources reflects the sense of place for the unfolding of this historic narrative and the adornment of the camel silhouette. The pyramidal design relates directly to High Jolly's role and his cultural background. This stone pyramid is the only tribute to an itinerant camel driver who played a key role in one of the most unusual experiments in U.S. military history. This is a story of great compassion, revealing High Jolly's love and training of camels, plus years of dedicated service to the United States Army. To this day, this monument and all that represents attract visitors and locals alike, while serving as a venue for community events. The pyramid stands in tribute to a man, an event, and to the many contributions made by the ethnic and cultural minorities in the settlement and king of the American West. The High Jolly Monument meets the National Register Criterion Consideration, C and F, as a grave and as a commemorative property, because its primary significance is its architectural merit, as described in the Associated Pyramidal Monuments in Arizona, 1925 to 1943. Multiple property documentation form. It is one of four pyramidal monuments in Arizona, exhibiting an Egyptian influence, and one of three constructed in native stone and concrete. This is the only one of the four with a decorative feature, a silhouette of a camel in steel on top of the peak of the pyramid. It's nominated as the state level of significance of one of four such monuments known to exist here. This listing provides recognition of the property's historic importance to the community and assures protective review of federal projects that might adversely affect the character of these historic properties. This monument is part of a select group of National Register Historic Places. Denise Ross began this process in 2009 of obtaining this recognition. The process was started before by Quartzsite historian Pauline Sandholt, but it was not completed at that time. Now I'd like to introduce Brenda Thompson of the Arizona, Executive Director of the Arizona Humanities Council.
All I can say about Quartzsite is it's bringing back memories of Buffalo, New York this morning. That similar feeling that I know I have toes, I just don't know exactly where they are. If you don't know about the Arizona Humanities Council, we're the Arizona chapter of the National Endowment for the Humanities. And so one of the things I have to do first off is thank you, because I wouldn't be here, or the Humanities Council wouldn't be here if it wasn't for taxpayers who care about history and culture and museums and libraries, and this is how your money is spent. One of the things Denise asked me to think about was, to talk about was, what's at stake? Why is history important? Why does historic preservation matter? And it's a hard question for me to answer, but I think the easiest way is to say, because sometimes we forget. Our job is to try to help people remember the stories of who we are, and that's by sharing them with each other. I think everybody loves a great story. This is one of them. And it's also an interesting story, but it's more than that. It's like a snapshot in the photo album of our family history. What family? The many faces and places and people that come here from all over the world that make up our country. And so Hunt Jolly's story is really the story of the United States, you know, how it came to be. His story is the story of Arizona, and so it's very fitting that his story is part of Arizona's centennial. And I think we tell the story because sometimes we forget. And the centennial is an opportunity for all of us to look back and remember. He was an interesting man, an immigrant. He was a miner, an explorer, a scout for the U.S. Army, a father, and a member of the community. He worked most of his life for the U.S. government, and he was skilled with unruly camels. And even just being on the stage today for a few minutes, I'm trying to imagine what it would be like to travel all the way from Texas to California, round trip and back. No air conditioning, no bottled water, no iPods, no cushioned seating, unless the camel's cushioned. I'm not so sure of that kind of cushioned seating. It took incredible perseverance, skill, tenacity, but most importantly, it took a love of this country. And I heard a story, I don't know if it was Denise that I read it from, or was it part of the other research that I did, but it was a story about Ali being in Los Angeles, and he was not invited to a picnic, and it kind of pissed him off. So he took his yellow cart and his two pet camels, and he drove through the picnic. He broke it up. I think there was a message there, and I think the message was, don't leave me out. I'm a part of this community. And I kind of wish he was here today to drive his cart and his camels through Congress, because I think sometimes they forget we belong to the picnic, too. It's not just a private party. They represent us. And so they shouldn't forget that we're part of the same family. It's kind of like having a family picture and leaving a few folks out. Don't leave a few folks out. Have a big picture. Let us all squeeze in there around the lumpy sofa. So I think if he were here today, one of the things he might say was, stop the fighting and bickering over little things. Get back in the picture and remember the big picture of the history of who we are as members of the United States. Don't forget the little people. It's we the people. And don't forget, we're all part of one big family. I wanted to say especially that we will not forget High Jolly. This monument is a testament to that. And so although sometimes we forget our history, this is not history that we will forget. High Jolly, I'd like to also say to you, happy birthday. His birthday was December 16th. And I think it's too cold to sing happy birthday, but I'll be thinking it, humming it to myself. Thank you for coming. And also, happy birthday to the people of Arizona for our centennial. And I actually do have some little birthday presents with me. If you're still here and your hands will actually open up, they're not frozen shut. I have some t-shirts and recipes from across Arizona, from the Humanities Council, a couple tote bags, and maps of Arizona. Happy birthday.
I forgot to mention that we did receive a phone call from the other step great-granddaughter, Shirley Price of San Antonio, Texas. And she's going to be keeping in touch with us by email. So we're proud to have her represented here and just be a part of our family here in Quartzsite, Arizona. I'd like to introduce now Dennis Dole. And Dennis?
Thank you very much, Pastor Bruce. And good morning. Boy, what an awesome opportunity to take a look into High Jolly's life. It's been quite a journey for me. I have a typed speech here. I may refer to it, but we're going to take a journey together. great idea. Guys, they went in and they even talked to Congress. Congress gave them $30,000 and sent a group over to Syria, to Turkey, into the Middle East to find these camels. And they found Haji Ali, Philip Al Teodoro, or Philip Tedro, or High Jolly. They found out that his knowledge of camels was second to none in the group they'd met anyway, so they sent him out, and he ended up purchasing the camels to bring them back to the United States. There were two groups, one that came in 1856 of 33 camels, the second arrived in Indianola, Texas in 1857 of 44 camels, along with Haji Ali. Now here we are, we're these soldiers, and here comes this gentleman in there that is, as he was described, as a swarthy little gentleman, which means he was dark-complected and small in stature. And they asked him what his name was, and he was telling them Haji Ali with probably a very thick Syrian accent. And so they called him High Jolly because that was just so much easier to remember. So they packed things up, and away they went on this experiment. The United States Army hired him for a year, and they started running supplies out of Texas into California, through New Mexico, Arizona. They thought it was a great success, except that they just really, the soldiers couldn't get this handle on these pumpy things. And so they decided they needed to have somebody to take care of them, these ill-tempered beasts. And so High Jolly was then kept around to take care of these beasts of burden. And he did a really good job up until about 1870, when the Army decided it was time to quit. They let him go. And here was High Jolly going, "Hey, I thought you guys had hired me for life." And he was looking for a pension. And because he had never enlisted in the United States Army, he was not eligible for a pension. So they turned him down. And so what did he do? He became a scout. He ran pack lines. He made sure that the military roads, the people along those that took care of the horses and provided stabling on long treks, had food, water for the horses. He took salt by camel into Nevada for the miners. Now, I never did realize just exactly how important salt was. And there was a time when it was one of the most precious things that man knew about. That's why when you spilled it, it was caused by the devil, so you grabbed a pinch of salt, threw it over your shoulder into the devil's domain, and just to keep you safe. But he hauled salt to the miners. He did whatever he could do to make his way through in this country, in the desert Southwest. He was instrumental in making sure that people that moved through here moved through with relative comfort. Now, if you can cause coming across on a horse, in a buggy, in a Conestoga wagon, whatever, comfort. But there were times when there had to have been some comfort stops. And he was the kind of person, his job made sure they had the supplies for these people. It was very important in what the desert Southwest has become. Now my journey is going to take me back to here. never end. But he also assisted General Cook in the search for Geronimo from 1882 to 1886. Sometime after that, he left Tucson and left his family and came to Quartzsite, where he was ran a pack line, where he prospected, where he made his living. He recaptured some of his camels when he got here, and that's what he used to make sure that he had what he knew to haul his supplies. A few years later, High Jolly fell ill, and in 1898, and again in 1901, they took him from Quartzsite to Tucson for treatment. On December 16, 1902, High Jolly passed away in an adobe shack and was buried at a local cemetery. After his many decades of service to the United States Army and the settlement of the desert Southwest, the fact that he had never enlisted in the Army, he was told he was not eligible for that all-important pension, and he died living on what his friends provided. Since his death, the legend of High Jolly has been passed on in newspapers and magazine articles, radio programs, books, movies, and even a song recorded by the New Christy Minstrels, as well as others. American folklore is as much a part of national identity as historical fact. High Jolly epitomizes the unusual juxtaposition of diverse immigrant cultures seeking freedom and prosperity, often ground between the shifting gears of ancient agrarian and modern industrial economies, wrote Mr. Jim Turner, a well-known Arizona historian. He continued, Philip Tedrow was never more than a working class poor, a foreigner of misunderstood origins, lost in a history dominated by white upper class males. Arizonans knew High Jolly as a pioneer and a local character instead of a major contributor to Western settlement. Mr. Turner concludes, given the nature of Western expansion, it is apropos that a Greek immigrant from the Arabian desert spent a 50-year odyssey taming America's largest desert, and that his deeds are still sung about around Southwestern campfires. A contributor of the Greek Review, Mr. Steve Frangos, points out, it is not Greek Americans who honor High Jolly with a memorial pyramid and special holiday, but Americans of every heritage across the nation. At the dedication of his tomb in 1934, state historian Elizabeth Toohey said, we left him alone to know the sting of poverty and humiliation of a man who outlived his usefulness. The tomb represents High Jolly's dedication to his adopted country and his beloved camels, and as such deserves a place on the National Register of Historic Places. Wow, what a journey. We've traveled from Syria into Turkey to Indianola, Texas, across the desert Southwest to Quartzsite, where a man died in his 70s that gave his much of his life to the United States of America and its new immigrants. And here we are today, finally, after 75 plus years, saying that High Jolly deserves, his memorial deserves to be on the Register of National Historic Places. What a journey. Thank you all again for coming.
Thank you, Dennis. You shared some information that a lot of us didn't know. So we really appreciate that. Again, yeah, the more that you look around, the more you see the importance of immigrants to this country. People that you wouldn't even think were important. You know, I've been on the cemetery board for 5-6 years, I guess, 5 years, 4 years. And, again, I hear so pilgrimage to unveil the plaque that commemorates this monument going into the National Register of Historic Places. Denise, if you would go. And we have some of the people that portrayed some of the characters during our spirit walk this last year. If you would all join us around the plaque, we're going to have that dedication, and Denise will make that presentation.
Their history, the history of this Pioneer Cemetery and the members in here, it's gonna live on through these players at our next historical walk in October. Come, you'll learn a lot more. If you need some more information, the museum is a great place. It's on Main Street here. The library is on Plymouth. It's a great place to come and visit for just those little tidbits more. We want to welcome every one of you, especially our speakers, our historic players. Every one of you is important as the next person standing next to you. Thank you.
That's pretty neat.
Anthony. I mean, my heart is out.